morning, everyone.
Good morning, guys.
It's a great pleasure to be here this morning. And it's also a great pleasure to see a few friendly faces in the audience. Some of you who work with me on a very regular basis, not looking in anybody's specific direction. But what's good is that they'll be able to keep me very honest. So as soon as I start veering off track, then just have a look at them. If they're nodding or shaking their heads, you'll get an indication of how valid and how useful it is in terms of the content that I'll be talking about. So I think we've got about a good hour, prop. Just double checking time wise.
1 hour, 1 hour,
1 hour, 20 minutes. 1 hour, 20 minutes? Okay, brilliant. So we can go through about an hour of content, I would say, and then we can also have some group discussion, but I also absolutely welcome some questions and topics, you know, as we go through the material. Just in terms of the reading material that was sent out, I've also included it in our talk this morning, so I've actually done a little bit of the hard work for you and got into some of those papers and extracted some thoughts. And of course, what will be useful for you is a little bit of interpretation about those authors' perspectives in terms of a South African organizational context. So we'll be able to have that debate, as well as lift out a few useful insights from their theories and their research, which I think is obviously the reason that you were given the papers. And I did pass on a couple others that I found useful in my own research. There's a lot of material out there. And I guess the purpose of something like this morning is really to bring it to a practical level and to say, right, so we're spending a lot of time at university, we're going to get a qualification, hopefully, and when we leave here, what is that impact that we want to have on the world out there? And as much as you can start to understand that before you actually walk out the door, I think you'll be able to just calibrate your learning focus and approach to gaining all the skills you possibly can before you're then almost out in the wide world as you can apply it and put it into practice. Right, so I guess the topic really was to look at Agile in South African organizations and just to talk about how I've really broken up the topic for this morning. We'll go through a little bit of a debate around the state of IT projects today. And a lot of my material is quite visual, so we'll have a lot more of a conversation than too much theory. I sent out a survey, and we did have some responses. I looked on SurveyMonkey last night, and there were some quite interesting responses. And just for those of you that didn't get a chance to have a look at it, I just asked for a bit of a perspective on use of Agile in SA organizations from your point of view. And there was one quite interesting question. We asked you to write an email to the project manager in an environment that you were going to be a part of. And I went through some of those sort of hypothetical emails. And we might read a couple of those out, and we can just gain some insight as to what type of approaches would work in terms of trying to influence. Because obviously the skills that you acquire here, the sort of agile thinking that is permeating the software development industry, also needs to filter into organizations. And believe me, those organizations do want to change, as much as sometimes it might not feel like it. And you are going to become change agents in that world out there. And it was useful for me just to see what your perspective now was, and hopefully over time you can become even more influential. Then this evolution of agile thinking, what I did was I took your pre-reading and I did a bit of a timeline in terms of when each of those papers was released, all the way from that Harvard Business Review paper, which was I think late 80s. When the sort of agile thinking really started to permeate common literature, all the way through to the latest, I think it was Schwab and a couple of the others, and obviously the Agile Manifesto is somewhere in the middle. So we'll just spend a slide on each of those papers and just see how that thinking has evolved over time. And what that'll do is it'll give you a flavor of that material without having to go into all of the detail. And then what I think is always useful is that you yourselves, based on your research and your interests, can then select which areas and which authors and which topics you are the most interested in. Because it must be the passionate areas of your research that will drive the energy and the willingness for you to make a career out of a specific topic in the software industry. And then all the way through, we'll bring in some anecdotes, and I'll ask my colleagues and yourselves as well. We've got real broad experience to give us some perspectives, and we'll finish then with a bit of the learnings from the field. Give a fair number of talks, and a recent talk I gave at DevOps Day, and I spoke about building a culture that encourages agile teams, and it's difficult to do that at different levels in the organization, and when you are in a position of influence and sometimes control, control is not always necessary, but when you can influence an environment, that cultural aspect I think is one of the most important things that you need to be quite tuned into. So we'll talk a little bit about that. And then self-organizing teams, I was just chatting to Sidwell and Manti actually outside, we were talking about self-organizing teams. And I think that's a topic for me. If there's one thing that you were to take away from today, is this concept. And in fact, we've got an expert in the room on this idea of swarm theory. You've done swarm theory. So that swarm theory that you find in nature actually has got a lot of parallels. And I've just got some pictures about robotic swarms and how, if you look at teams that self-organize in organizations, they're quite successful. But there are some other conditions, a successful environment, a supportive and trusting leadership team, etc. around them. But that self-organizing capability, once it gets going, it becomes quite powerful. And organizations actually rely, if you look at some of the papers, they rely on that bottom-up agile adoption. When agile is sort of implemented top-down, it can be a bit of a blunt instrument. And then now we're just doing agile as opposed to doing waterfall, but there's a sense that you actually need to be agile. And to be agile, it's got to be something that's really got to come through from the bottom up. And that self-organization of teams, of people like yourselves, who understand theory and that can apply the practice, becomes quite a powerful combination to achieve the success that you want to. And then I had put the FNB CodeFest video at the end, and Sital suggested that I put it at the beginning. So we're going to play that right up front. Has anybody heard of the FNB CodeFest?
Yeah.
Okay, brilliant. So we've managed to get quite a little bit of exposure. We're going to be running our third session in about 4 or 5 weeks. And really, it's a hackathon. The video is about 5 or 6 minutes, and it's quite self-explanatory. But I think for the purposes of this morning, there's one interview right in the middle where the guy talks about Brandon Stafford. He ran at the time our IT department in our fiduciary business, and he's done a lot of work around evangelizing for Agile, and he talks a little bit about his observations of CodeFest, and I think you all pretty much understand the idea of a hackathon, but what he found was this almost emergence of Agile practices from these people that had come to this hackathon environment, wanted to win some prizes, wanted to solve some business problems in a very concentrated, intense environment. And under those circumstances, the most efficient way of working automatically became the Agile principles. It was almost like we hadn't imprinted everybody's minds with this Agile way of working necessarily, but when we put them under certain conditions, it was naturally the Agile principles that emerged out of that environment. So we'll play that, I think, first, get us going, get a little bit of energy into the room, and then go into material. Is that going to be useful? Is there anything else that you'd like to add in or ask right up front? I am recording it, by the way, so I'll put it on YouTube, and then anybody that wasn't around can have a look at the video. So feel free to ask any questions, and I can edit it out if you wanted to. All right, so yes, sir.
So from all the reviews and so forth, that's my observation.
Yes.
There's a lot, and even referring to the focus, that it's very much like the development people that get involved with this kind of thing.
Yes.
There's a business understanding.
Great question, and I urge you to watch the video, and let's have that conversation after the video, because what I feel quite passionately we managed to do with CodeFest is we managed to create a week within which we were working optimally from a business and an IT perspective. And what I've asked you to do is have a look out for the lady who says that she feels we should be working like this on a permanent basis.
And that lady is the CEO of our savings and investments business. So I guess to answer your question, absolutely do need business involved. The question then is, how do you get it involved? And here's an example, I think, of getting it right for just a couple of days. And the trick now that I wrestle with is to say, well, if people were so enthusiastic about that, and we want to achieve these agile principles without enforcing it on people, but under the right conditions, that was automatically what emerged, how do we take that back to the office? And how do we go, and you'll see a lot of the guys talking about it, saying, you know, this fat code fest is our factory floor. This is where these guys are writing the code. This is what we need. This is how we need these guys to be optimized. And it's almost like the large organization has moved so far away from being able to set up these ideal environments that we now have to go away from the office to achieve the right way of working. And it's become this dilemma that we are dealing with as well as many other companies of saying, well, we know what the answer is, but the challenge is actually to make it work and implement it on a daily basis. So good point, and have a look for that in the video. Any other equally useful thoughts before we go into the video? And I've got some sound here, so I hope it's going to work.
This is a fantastic opportunity to collaborate across the group. I mean, to have the Ashburton, ourselves as R&B, FNB, First Chain Corporate Centre, as well as West Bank, all in the same room, cross-pollinating teams, different ideas from different areas, and just seeing the amount of crossover collaboration and opportunities this provides for the group to really accelerate and go after what we call moonshots, I think is really amazing.
Code Fest, totally different. It's just illuminating what's next from an IT perspective, and really I'm enjoying the fact that you've taken all the bureaucracy out and put business together with RT and making magic happen.
So it's nice to get around with users. We don't know, experience gets shared. It's pretty cool. It's a cool environment, it's a very cool concept. And it's a lot more fun to do my work from here than it is to sit in my seat. We have to find solutions that make a difference to our customers. What's good for our customers will be good for our businesses. And so as best as we can, in this whole process, in accelerating innovation, it can in return help our customers. I was just talking to some of the different teams and some of the ideas that the people have here. I mean, it is amazing that over a period of 24 hours, we can do things that will typically, you know, in the industry, if you look around, can take a year or so, and this guy allowed to do it over a period of 24 hours. Very simply, what we're doing is we want to build the expertise of blockchain technology in the bank. We feel that it's something which is going to help us future-proof the bank against threats from more traditional players, people like Apple, Pay, Facebook. We've got a banking license. Google, you know, that banking licenses in 37 states in the US. So we really want to build a skill base, an expertise base in the bank. And the way we're doing it is we're building a training system, which we're going to use in Treasury initially, for training purposes, to teach people how to trade, to work in a Treasury environment. And blockchain technology is great for that. We have a ledger, built-in ledger, we can do trades on the blockchain. So that's what we're building. Traditionally, branch-based infrastructure with remote intensive, so, and it's actually hard to get stuff done. That model is there.
For me, what we're doing at CodeFest is absolutely at the core of what we want to do as a business and should be doing as a business. In fact, I would love us to do this on a daily basis. We all have techie teams like this together the whole time.
I think that CodeFest really talks to the way that an agile team should be working. And, you know, agile is more than methodology, it's more principle and practice. And what we see here is you can look around, you see people sitting in huddles, they're doing work that's not just one discipline, so they're working, they're doing analysis, they're doing testing, they're doing development, they're doing all of those things. And I think that's one of the key aspects of agile, is make sure that people can say, you know, I'm not just a developer, I'm actually going to think and understand the business problem, I'm going to build a solution that meets that business problem. I'm going to be able to write the test for that, so we can test it, we can automate it, all those kind of things. And what I'm really excited about seeing here is a lot of the teams have started embracing things like continuous build, continuous integration, those sorts of things, to be able to make sure their projects are building as they're building them right here. So I think some really great that's on this forum that says, when we leave here and we go back to the office, actually when we do our projects, we should do it from a this type of perspective where let's huddle around a room or a desk, whatever it may be, and actually just get our work out. It's a lot faster, and it's a lot more agile, which is the awesome part. I mean, at the end of the day, like I said just now, this is our factory floor. This is where we push out our widgets at the end of the day, and if these guys are working quicker and faster and more agile, that's ultimately the competitive advantage that we have.
Pushing out their widgets, and then they come in and they show, this actually works really well. Why can't we do this back in the office? And instead of coming from a theoretical, principle, textbook-based mindset, okay, you've got that in your back pocket where the people do ask you, and you can explain why it works and where it came from, etc. Demonstrate it, make it real for people. And I think, you know, that's the one learning hopefully that potentially you've taken out of it. And, you know, come and talk to me and I can explain to you and I can give you all the materials to how you want to set this up. And we've got a fairly standard template now that we just run the code fest on and we push everybody through a sort of 6-day sprint process almost that in 4 or 5 weeks time we'll have another version of this running, which will be even bigger and better this year. Yeah.
Just going to ask, is it open to anyone or just...
We can talk, absolutely. We have a mechanism for bringing students and sponsors and partners in. Definitely no other banks, but if it's non-financial services, absolutely come in and have a talk to us. You'll see there, we did publicize the Kids Savings app that was built at CodeFest, and I think you might have seen the press that a bank are releasing one end of this month or next month. So obviously the trick is you can do all the cool stuff and you can build lots of apps and CodeFest, but you've got to get them, you know, into production. You've got to get that business sponsorship. So it almost proved the model that it was such an experimental once-off that because you couldn't get some of those apps into production, that if you were able to replicate this back in the office and keep that way of working, you would further improve the chances of getting those apps into markets quicker and better. And remember what Agile does, it gives you that collaboration, that speed to market, and then improve customer collaboration, which ultimately creates the type of software that your users will want to adopt and take up, which is effectively what, if you look at the exponential organizations and the sort of slick, frictionless services that they've been offering and that people have started to adopt through microservices, like Airbnb and Uber and so on, all household names that you're quite familiar with, and services that we consume on a daily basis, those all came out of this agile way of working, which is highly experimental, highly iterative, highly collaborative, highly intense. Facebook's like button came out of their internal hackathon. Google pioneered the idea of 20% time. They allowed their developers to do anything that they wanted to every Friday. And they just said, look, it's going to be loosely linked to the organization's general objectives, but we're not going to tell you what to do. You guys are pretty bright. You can go and figure it out. And through that experimental time that they had in the office, they were able to deliver things like Gmail, map searches, etc. And that didn't come out of a big upfront design of people going away for 6 months and then coming up with a massive big document that then handed over to IT, which magically produced the software they wanted. All right, so let's just then get into a little bit of the presentation for this morning. And this just graphically illustrates, I think, the dire state of IT at the moment. And it is pretty serious. I'll show you some stats on the next page of the Standish Group produces the Chaos Report every year. It's worth just downloading. But this kind of just anecdotally, I think, paints quite a humorous picture. And I'm sure you've seen variations of this. But if you look at the different perspectives that people have on IT projects, it's really quite an indictment of how badly IT projects in general are perceived. And I think you'll see on the next page, it's less than 15% globally of IT projects come in under budget, on time, and achieve the outcomes that was expected. So are there any of these that jump out to you? Are there any of these that you feel is maybe a little bit unfair on those roles? I mean, how about this one? How the project was documented? Okay. Yeah, it's blue sky, exactly. So all this blue sky over here never made it onto any kind of piece of paper. And a lot of people come to me and say, oh, but Agile makes us lazy and, you know, it's an excuse to get around governance and grid principles, etc. Absolutely not. Agile's not about being lazy. Agile's actually about being efficient. It's about bringing those Japanese lean manufacturing principles out of the real engineering factories and into the software engineering environment. So it doesn't mean to say that you're not going to have documentation. The Agile principle says reduce the amount of unnecessary work as much as possible. So yes, risk and compliance and governance have added a lot of unnecessary documentation and keep you busy for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks. You need to be strong enough in your belief and your understanding of the Agile principles to push back on it. Not that you then say we don't need any documentation because we're just making it up as we go along, but that there's enough documentation that is valuable to the other people in the project and those that have to support it, etc. Okay, so how about how it was supported, right? How the customer was billed. Yeah, right, so the customer saying, yeah, I'm paying for this. And just, I think it was in one of the papers, I can't remember, but there was a couple of case studies, it was in the Standish report, just some of the worst IT projects, and I think in Denver or something, they've spent now 15 years and they still don't have a baggage handling system. It's now more expensive to stop the project, okay, than to keep it going. So they've got to be this unbelievably dysfunctional environment around the amount of money that they've already spent on it, that they cannot actually get out of it. So this idea of customer value for money is a real challenge as well. And I guess from a support perspective, you've got Agile and then you've got DevOps, which is that support maintenance approach, which is the cousin, if you like, of Agile. This is, okay, so Agile deals with your software development and your collaboration between business and IT to get better projects delivered. But once they're in production, that DevOps maintenance process is another topic that we can talk about in some detail. But actually on that point, we're hosting the next DevOps Day on the 29th of September. So www.africadevopsday.com. And you can come into the CodeFest environment the week before CodeFest. And we'll be hosting about 300 people from across the industry. And everybody will be talking about DevOps topics, but also Agile. So if your interest is more Agile, definitely come on the day and you'll get some value out of it. All right, so there's a few humorous aspects, I think, that I always like to refer back to. But as I said, the Standish Group report from 2015 indicated, and it's probably the most respected, most credible research report on the state of IT projects globally. And I would just urge you to go and Google it when you've got a chance. What they're saying there was that about 50% of projects were project challenged. Okay, so they've got basically three categories where projects are successful, and that's, I think, about 13% or so. And then project challenged is at least
least 50%, and then below that is just complete disasters. Just irrecoverable, they were cancelled, just nightmare scenarios. And in some cases, it's almost impossible to really calculate the cost of these failed projects. They say that even their results is just the tip of the proverbial iceberg. And then again, you've got lost opportunity costs, etc., easily going into the trillions of dollars. So there is this big debate between waterfall and agile, and people saying, no, agile's all over the place, and eventually we'll come back to this proper structured process. But the stats tell a very plain picture. We have to do something differently. And we'll come just now to the evolution of thinking in agile and this agile manifesto where these people came together and recognized this. And about 2001, 2002, he said, look, we have to fix this. Our industry is losing credibility. Because when IT walks into the room, you know, business just says, here we go now, how late is it going to be, how much is it going to cost me? Now, yes, a lot of issues can be parked at the door of business, but IT's got to own that process and that methodology and that way of delivering their responsibility, their input to the organization, and then take on that journey in a way that improves these results. And I passionately believe that Agile is an approach that is worth looking at and considering and trying to push for as much as possible. These stats here are also very important. So again, user involvement, and this talks to that business collaboration topic. So you have, business involvement at the level of the users to give that feedback is one of the critical success factors or points of failure for these projects. Requirements is again there, so number 3 and number 2 there. And for the most challenged projects, requirements and specifications are actually the biggest driver of the failed projects. And the point is, we'll look at a quote from one of the papers just now, is that actually businesses don't know what they want. And they can't write it down to the level of detail that they think you want. And that's a dilemma that we have to get out of. And if you look at what we did with CodeFest, we did enough collaboration up front that when we put everybody together in the room, the relationships and the trust and interaction between the human beings in the room was good enough that they were able to co-create the instructions for the machine that ultimately becomes a software that they both never knew or could have conceptualized before they walked into that room. It was only a product of that collaboration once they agreed that they both needed to do it together. So this idea of sequentially being able to hand over specifications to somebody else there to hand off and carry on with that work, this notion of sequential software development, I really feel that's gone, that's out the window. Collaborative parallel, and mentally talk a lot about design thinking and making sure that we embed that into every step of the process, I really think is the way that the IT world is moving. So as I said, let's just look at some of the results from the survey. And I asked a few questions, and your results are up there on the screen. Any thoughts on the survey? Any thoughts on the questions that were asked? Most common agile method in SA being Scrum. And I certainly think from a corporate perspective, and we'll talk a little bit later about that hybrid model, Scrum is definitely the agile approach that best fits into existing corporate governance and standards around software development. Because look, you're not going to achieve the improvements that you want in the companies that you go and work for through a revolution. It's going to be an evolution. And you have to realize it's an inch by inch mindset. Right? So you're gonna gain benefits bit by bit. And get away from this notion that, you know, we all want to go out there and win a Nobel Prize or change the world or solve world hunger. Yes, there are a select few people on the planet. You may be one of them. Fantastic news. Call me, come and work for you. Most of us are going to have a long, hard slog just to claw benefits and deliver outcomes that we think are useful. And Scrum, as I say, fits in the most with the way that large organizations work, in without the most disruption, if you like. And then from establishing Scrum and self-organizing teams, you can then start to influence broader and broader in the organization. And almost what I find is that when you start to have multiple Scrum teams across the organization, then it starts to permeate and it starts to impact the culture, and the culture starts to impact the approach, and the approach starts to impact the strategy. And all of a sudden the board is talking about agile and saying, well,
IT guys are doing some cool stuff. We as business now also need to learn about it and formalize our agility as an enterprise. And then you've got a nice connection between business and IT. So there's some challenges there. I think this one, like I was saying now, getting buy-in and agreement on adopting an agile approach. I'm not certain that you have to really get too much explicit buy-in and support. If you spend all your time running around thinking that all of a sudden, due to your own ability to convince people of an idea, they're magically going to change, good luck. But I much prefer this experimental demonstration of the results for people to then learn from and start to buy in gradually. That's how you change a nation, that's how you change a society, that's how you change thinking. So you have to be enough upfront to say, look, you know, can we just experiment? Can we try doing some prototyping? And I remember coming in 2 years ago when I joined business banking, and there was no agile, there was no prototyping, there was no agile development, it was big upfront design, and there was one project that started off, and I said, guys, look, can we do a couple of prototypes? So I'm actually quite happy for the IT team to go away and, you know, draw something on the whiteboard, and then we'll take that and we'll come back to you, and we'd rather collaborate and improve that design on the basis of working software. Remember that value of agile? We value working software over comprehensive documentation. So you switch it from detailed business specifications to getting to working software as soon as possible, and then you go back to that documentation and you improve it. Why? Because people can relate to something that they can touch and feel a lot easier than they can relate to a piece of paper and a set of documentation. So you're not necessarily going to have to get massive buy-in and support, and then all of a sudden we're agile.
Yeah. It's incremental. Yes, sir.
Peter, I don't want to distract too much, but I've got this question that at that point where we can kick off and say, okay, let's make a prototype or let's experiment a little bit, management usually also asks, please come up with a budget for time and a budget for cost.
Yeah.
But the whole process of prototyping is actually to discover what the requirements are so that we can. So, I mean, this catch 22, they want me to budget, but I don't have the requirements yet.
Yeah, it is, because you're still a service provider at the end of the day. So what you have to do is try and carve out a little bit of capacity. And again, coming back to code fests, if you can at least get an agreement to say, let's do a code fest, and then the number of times in so many different projects we have exactly the same conversation, and I say, well, you know what, your guys are coming to code fest anyway, and I have people coming to tell us they would take leave to come to code fest. So you've got that capacity in the room already for 2 or 3 days. Go and build some prototypes in the room during COVID. And it's a sunk cost that everybody's agreed to. It's like they think it's like a team building event for IT, right? And then you saw on the screen there 42 apps developed in 24 hours. You go back and say, look, we built this prototype. They say, oh, that's quite interesting. No, but now can you put this button over there and this screen over there? And in the conversation, you know this whole idea of play the ball, not the man, right? And I find that the business IT conversation is often that kind of emotional, antagonistic conversation. Now you put a ball in play. That's why I love Scrum. The Scrum is about, it's a rugby metaphor, right? So what is the purpose of Scrum? Scrum is to get the ball into play. And I love, when I talk to my business colleagues, a lot of guys, they watch rugby and sports on the weekend, I can talk about the sporting analogies, a sprint, okay? We'll talk a bit about it. You know, the agile guys were really clever because they used these anecdotes that business people could relate to. So you say, let's have a quick Scrum. Okay, let's try and get the ball into play. Let's get a prototype. You know what we're going to do? Now we're going to sprint. Because now we understand what it is that you want. You can document it if you want, but now, I mean, how many times do you see a developer, and I always say this, when they sit down in the morning, and they open up their laptop, and they're going to start coding. And I say, where is that specification? Look in the drawer. Lost that specification. Get this bit now. I have to have my specification before I start coding. So, well, Moses, you see that? Oh, Davies. Oh, forget it, man. They can't even find a lunchbox. Okay? So the conversation has to change, and it has to be around the working software. So as quickly as you can get to that and use a focus, ask the guys to stay up later after work, whatever the case may be, get to working software as quickly as possible. Okay, guys, I asked about the important principles of Agile. I think there's a couple here. And this one we've been talking about now, earliest delivery of working software or feature. Right? Satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery of valuable software. working software is the primary measure of progress. So you guys are almost answering that question there, because they say get your prototype as quickly as possible, and then it makes all the other conversations a lot easier.
Maybe this is applicable. During the period 2000-2000, I was privileged to be working on a project in North in the maritime navigation arena. And just interestingly, we didn't know about Agile at that point.
Yes.
But if I look at the way that we used waterfall,
yes.
We knew what the product had to do, but there were a number of components.
Yeah.
So if I take what we did with each component,
yeah,
it very much resembles Agile, because it was based on the fact that we had to,
yeah,
to deliver a working product in the same environment.
Yeah. So, and you know what? Don't be an Agile future. Okay, because then you'll set up an Agile versus Waterfall conversation again. If your project has Waterfall and Agile features in it, the principles or ways of working, but you're getting to working software, you're achieving the principles out of Agile, who cares what you call it? I've actually said it F&B, I don't want to hear the word Agile. And you know what it is? There's a difference between capital A and A. And some of my articles that I sent out, I said B, Agile, lowercase a, at becoming Agile, capital A. So there's a proprietary approach to delivering software, which is the capital A and A. But be flexible. Change as you go. And I think the point that you made there is, so what if business said, well, you know, we're still doing a waterfall project because we've got a design phase and a build phase, but actually in reality, you're collaborating, you're prototyping, you're iterating, you're learning, you're going backwards and forwards, and then those principles start to emerge. You say, actually, you know what, there's a name for this. It's called a scrum, or it's called a daily stand-up, it's called a sprint. And you say, well, you see this Agile principle, let's actually just adopt that. And the other question I asked you guys was, can you do all or nothing? And I certainly believe that Agile is a toolbox. And you just have these tools available to you. And some of them are going to work and some of them are not going to work. If you try and force it, you take a strong position that you have to defend. And that business always gets nervous about that. So be willing to compromise and to be flexible, I think, is important. We've spoken about selectiveness there. Let's skip the roles. Companies in the world that best uses Agile. And then in South Africa, very thrilled to see F&B on the list there twice. I don't know if that was you two F&B guys over there. Most probably. any thoughts? Obviously ThoughtWorks is there. I think they're quite well established as an industry leader. And there are good consultants out there and good players that are able to influence. And I think of Agile 24 and I think of Intellect. And you know, I think a lot of good, very capable thinkers out there that are influencing these large organizations. ABSA is currently going through a massive Agile transformation journey. They're focused on massive programs of training. So they're going through a learning and enabling approach to achieving Agile, which I think is fantastic if we engage with them quite a little bit. Right, so let's get into this idea of the evolution of thinking. And what I've done is I've taken the 8 papers that was sent out in the pre-reads, and I've just mapped them out in a timeline, and then I put the manifesto there in 2001. So the next 8 or 9 slides or so will just be some insights from each of those papers, and we'll just spend more or less time on each one of those as we go. But I wanted to just bring the academic thinking of the research that these guys have done into our discussion this morning, and then as we go, apply it to the SA organizational context. So, Taki Yuchi, and this was, as I say, late 80s, realized that this, and I used the word sequential earlier, remember I said this idea of sequencing? It's not new. Mid 80s, they realized that this traditional sequential relay race approach, right, so handing over the baton one to the next, was not going to be as effective. So even NASA, okay, they pioneered it. I mean, you know, CMMI, Carnegie Mellon, all these guys, process maturity, what an engineer. I mean, I'm an engineer, so I like structure, I like process, I like to know how things work. But software development is actually such a creative process that actually engages the human psychologies of people on projects at such a deep level And unfortunately, IT spent so much time on input-output processes, we've actually lost a little bit of that almost warm and fuzzy human psychology that actually helps drive the right approach to software development. And what he said was that rather set up a rugby type of approach, and again, you've got Scrum coming out of there, teams go the distance as a unit, business and IT, passing the ball, the prototype, backwards and forwards, until they achieve success, and which may then better serve today's competitive requirements. And again, I like the visualization because the sporting analogy is so good in South Africa, it's so good for business, they understand it. And one of my articles talks about use sprints to get out of the forest. And the problem with these Gantt charts, and you know, we try and think we can put our Gantt charts together and then we spend all our time updating Microsoft Project. Business looks at that and they feel like they're in a forest. And they actually, rather than watching a sprint or a relay race or a rugby match, they actually feel like they're watching a three-legged sack race. And these people come dashing over the forest and then rush off somewhere else over there. And then when they try and challenge, and they try and engage, and then the answer they get from us, IT, is no, you don't understand. It's a very complex project. It's a very complex product that we're trying to build. It's a very complex architecture. Instead, let me just turn my screen. I want to show you, business. Look at this cool software we're building. Click here, you see what you get. This is what your customers can experience. I'm busy working on this for our demo tomorrow. Do you want to come and have a look at it? And you can give us some input. Now, obviously that's a cultural luxury if you can have those type of conversations. But even back in the mid-80s, they realized that this idea of subtle control, not this top-down, hierarchical, bureaucratic approach, was going to lead to an organizational transfer of learning. And then again, this idea of self-organizing project teams coming through there quite strongly. Refactoring, anybody know a bit more about refactoring than I do? It's probably quite easy. So refactoring, as I understand it, the little research that I did, was to say you might be inheriting some code, you might have written some code, but once again, don't be too precious about what you've created. And the beautiful thing about code is that it's actually entirely digital, right? It's not like you're building a house. You can't be agile about building a house. You need an architect. Okay? Once you put those bricks down and you put that foundation up, you're building that house. The only agile analogy that I can think of when you're building a house is when you're creating a townhouse complex, right? So they don't build all the units. They build one, and then they have a show unit. And then people come and they say, would you like one down by the river? Would you like one by the road? Do you want one by the kids' park? And then you have this iterative learning based on a prototype of what a unit would look like. But from a coding perspective, it's this idea of altering the existing software. So that as you go, you almost design it to the way that you want it, rather than the way that you wanted it back then. Because you know what? The world is changing at ever faster paces. And the learning cycles are getting tighter and tighter and tighter. If you're not able to apply that into the work that you do, even at the code level, you're going to get stuck in protecting things that you've created just because you don't actually want to almost admit that they were wrong by creating an environment of continuous learning and continuous development. And the point of the diagram here is, in many cases, you still get the overall outcome and function and shape of the code, but you've optimized maybe your libraries and interfaces and integration and so on within the code that improves its runtime and speed, its features, etc. So have a look at this idea of refactoring. I've found it quite interesting, the little, as I say, that I've done to have a look at it. We spoke about this earlier. And this was straight out of the paper by Beck. Users didn't tell us once and for all exactly what they wanted. They didn't know. They contradicted themselves. And then what we did was we said, well, I want everyone to sign off. And we have a sign off page in front of the BRS, right? So everyone has to sign off. So once you sign off, yeah, all right. Once you sign off, now I know we're going to invest all this time building the software because I've got that signature, right? Okay, it's not worth a piece of paper it's written on once it's been signed. It just absolutely isn't. And all that is a starting point. It's a useful starting point because it reflects the sum total of everyone's design thinking, as good or bad as it might be at that time, in a document. Start with that document. Nothing wrong with it. But be willing to refactor it, be willing to change, be willing to continue to learn. And what XP is saying is that instead of having these big phases, you have a little bit more iterative phrases, and then Actually, Beck's actually moved away from XP, by the way. I don't know if you want to go and Google it, but I think this is quite extreme. This very tight cycles of analyze, design, implement, test, etc. And I think again, like most things in life, it's somewhere in the middle where you can incorporate a little bit of a structured sort of approach to the phases of a project and make it a little bit faster, but not so fast that people actually can't comprehend what you're doing at the pace that you want to do it, which is the extreme programming mindset. Which I think is a good name because it's just a little bit extreme for people to understand. So then we have the wonderful Agile Manifesto, and I believe that, I don't know how many people it was, went up into the mountains. And what I really like is if you go on this website, which was sent out, click onto the history page and go and read that history, and you'll actually get some really nice insights as to what the people were doing and trying to accomplish when they went off into the mountains and eventually came out with the Agile Manifesto. And for the application of Agile in SA organizations, which is our topic for this morning, read this first sentence. Companies have to rid themselves of their Dilbert, you know Dilbert?
Yes.
Everyone knows Dilbert, right? Dilbert manifestations of make work and arcane policies. I see it every day. Moses, Sibyl, do we see it every day? Yeah? Arcane policies. Make work, roles, people, manufacturing documentations. Then we're going to see the light of day. And I continually say to my teams, what are we about? We're about creating cool software for users that want to improve the way they work. Isn't that right? Okay. And anything else, and what we've done is we put a lot of facts, and a lot of issues, and a lot of processes in between there. It's crept in, and we've got to bring the users and the developers back together. And it's you guys, the guys who know how to create the code, that can work the magic. So it's up to leadership and the people that can create the environments to adopt these agile processes. What they say is, quite frankly, it scares the corporate bureaucrats because they're happy pushing process for the sake of process versus doing the best for the customer, as I say, the user, the person that's going to log in and click around and use your software and deliver something timely and tangible as promised. They run out of places to hide. So that's also what I find in the SA organizational context is your top executive level, they get this stuff. They want efficiencies. They want feature teams that deliver cool software. Guys on the bottom, which is us, we're at the bottom of the food chain, we get it. 100%. You know what the problem is? It's in the middle. Okay? And I'm doing some research, and I'm using the analogy of the middle management being the Dilberts, right, that have created these arcane make work policies. And we were talking earlier about holacracy. Where a company in South America was just abolished all line management structures and said, self-organize. You know what I want to do. These are the outcomes I want to achieve. Boom. So this middle management layer is almost the antivirus structure of the organism of the body. And Agile starts to come in and it treats it like a virus. Yeah? And it starts to act to isolate it and to eject it from the body. Yeah? And as that middle management starts, you know, and the sort of the warriors at the gate start to assemble, and you start to realize, you know, we've been through it, I can tell you. I mean, so all we've got war stories, eh?
Yes, yes.
So, and it scares them because they don't know what to do. They've come out of a traditional way of working, and we'll talk a bit later about this idea that management is based on a leadership principle that is not conducive to agile. Management is based on the transactional style of leadership. There's about 8 different styles of leadership principles. And we see them in great leaders around the world, and we've had a number of our own in this country that we're very fortunate to have been able to observe in action. But companies are built on hierarchies and structures that are derived from the Industrial Revolution and the army. Okay? Command and control. You have to have absolute discipline. But the leadership principles that we require in organizations, and I think organizations, regardless of IT, are realizing this as well, is much more servant leadership. And people in positions of control actually getting out of the way and saying, I'm here to serve you, and I'm here to make sure that you're going to be successful. I gave a talk at the Scrum Alliance at the end of last year, and did a similar type of topics. And at the end, one person said, you know, we've been trying for, I think it was 6 months or so. We have a Scrum area, and there's a table, there's a massive table bolted to the wall where they're trying to get their Kanban boards and put their sticky notes up for their daily stand-up meetings.
and they couldn't get that table moved for a year. And that's a failure of leadership to create the environment within which those people would be successful. All right. Continuous design. You heard about it in the CodeFest video, and that's just a little bit more continuous integration. And then just here, yeah, good comments. When I start a project, I actively avoid deciding on a design. I implement the first feature, see where it takes me, and implement the step. So again, you've got this iterative prototyping approach at the code level, right? So you now having to create that prototype is going to consist of a number of features. At the code level, you don't have that fully signed off agreed design because you know that even if you did, it would change once you delivered the product. But you yourself, in producing something as a minimum viable product that you can then talk about and do a demo, might benefit from this type of thinking, which is continuous design. As someone who, look at this, a lot of people, and this is why I called it the evolution of thinking. So these great thinkers, and this is the mark of great leadership, is being able to change your position and say, I was wrong. I've learned now, I understand. And this guy says, as someone who used to strongly advocate upfront design, I'm surprised by how successful this continuous design has been. My designs are now simpler and easier to extend than they were with upfront design. Okay, so just an interesting point here around continuous design. Integrated requirements engineering, we were talking about this a little bit about outside as well. And you saw the Standish report that for the project challenged category, the second and third biggest reason for failed projects was unclear or changing requirements, okay? And the problem is that you set the project up on the assumption that you've got clear requirements. Agile says set the project up on the basis that you don't have clear requirements. So if you go in on that basis, you know that you continuously have to engage and interact as those requirements and the understanding by business of what they want and how well they're able to articulate it into the IT team is going to develop and change on a day-by-day, hour-by-hour basis. So if you start on that basis, you're never going to be surprised. You're going to work on that basis. And again, you come to ideas of co-location and making sure that the team are working together. I mean, we've all got lots of stories about co-location, lots of hilarious anecdotes of F&B. But again, CodeFest is an example at scale. 250 developers and business coming together, as I say, in a fishbowl. Illustrating what's possible when you've got that collaboration and people working together. So again, new approaches to software development, the need for business to respond quickly to new opportunities and challenges mean that we must rethink requirements engineering's role in software development. So business themselves are also responding to a changing market and changing demands from their industry and new entrants and changing customer requirements. So it's almost unfair of us to expect our business colleagues to have this perfect vision and crystal ball. Remember, the project's going to take a year or whatever it is, so you're designing for an end point that everybody is only able to estimate and visualize. If you sit through the business and say, look, I understand things are going to change. I understand you're not able to articulate everything you want right now, but let's go into this together and let's build feature by feature, product by product, sprint by sprint, scrum by scrum. And that circular diagram there shows how that process as he proposes it should work. And then Scrum Guide, so good that you all thought Scrum being the most popular agile method in the country is good, because if you look at some of these points in yellow, it goes directly against management, right? And if you were to write the management textbook, right, what would it say? It would say management gets to intervene, right? Okay? Manager, the team reports to the manager. Yeah? This is anti-management. It is. It's called what it is. And I can tell you now, a lot of companies around the world are just saying, well, do we really need this middle management there? We've set the structure up, spans and layers, you know the concept of spans and layers, and people have made careers out of being managers. Right? Do we need managers? And that's a real challenge that people are starting to grapple with. But here you've got the self-organizing, self-actualization approach to software development. And frankly, I think as human beings, we all want a little bit of that in our lives, right? We don't want to be forced into a rut. We want to be able to determine our own destiny. We want to be able to achieve things that we feel we've had a role in creating with other people. And then again, you can read this, but you know, there's the basic events or ceremonies almost, if you like, and the way they fit into this cyclical process, and how we then inspect and adapt Tim's team here between the two as we operate each of these different events. And when people have looked at Scrum, they've said this is actually one of the 21st century is probably the, one of the most radical insights and approaches that you can apply to anything, regardless of IT. I see lots of business projects where I actually say to the guys, look, take some of these Scrum principles, and then whatever it is that you're doing, do this iterative, collaborative approach to the outcome that you want to achieve. And it's equally applicable in their worlds as it is in IT. Discipline, agile delivery, I don't know if you've heard about that. When I talk to the longer, more, the guys who've got a couple of decades experience in corporates and they've been doing agile and they've seen things come and go, discipline agile seems to be the one agile approach that has quite a bit of credibility in more areas and thinking than others. So I would suggest have a look at discipline agile delivery. They even take the Agile Manifesto and its principles and they start to just reword it slightly. So again, it's an enterprise-aware mindset of doing agile. Because if you start a company like they do in Silicon Valley, in a garage, like Steve Jobs did and many other companies are doing now, becoming exponential in their growth, the creation of cool software, they have a blank sheet of paper. The fact is you're going into an enterprise, like it could be been around 175 years. The simple fact of the matter is that it exists with processes and ways of doing things. And rather than coming with this revolutionary idea, coming with something that brings great ideas and thinking in, but as part of the way that environment is really functioning. But never being satisfied with not achieving as much as you possibly can. Never being complacent, never giving up. The discipline agile just gives you that structure. Now, let's talk about hybrid. So there's this idea that's starting to, and again, discipline agile is not about water scrum ball, but it's a starting point to say, well, we understand that projects are set up sequentially and you've got large program management offices, okay, and they want to see, and they want to report on successes. And remember, they've got a portfolio of projects. So PMI might have 20 different projects and they want to see how many projects in design phase are in green, amber, or red, or whatever the case may be, okay? And Water Scrum 4 brings the Scrum iterative principles that we spoke about on the previous slide into the middle part of this overall project life cycle. Okay? Now, think about a large organization, which is our topic again this morning. You're typically going to have monthly releases on a large core backend environment. Okay? Now, when we're doing custom builds on a channel, right, you're not going to be able to release code on the backend at different times, just going to be physically impossible. FMB has a large Hogan mainframe environment, we have monthly releases. So typically, they will take those monthly releases in through this cycle on a monthly basis. So all we have to do is make sure that when we want to release a potentially shippable product over here, we synchronize it with the monthly releases. And we work with a little bit of foresight, so Agile can't just be about making up as you go along, like I said earlier. That includes opportunity to be scrumming and sprinting with backlogs and iterative development while we're doing the coding and the testing. And that VRS that I mentioned earlier is still there, it's still got all the signatures on. It's going to be worthless by the time you get over here, but you don't have to tell anybody that. What I'm saying, you don't have to go throw it in their face and say, see, I told you this document's not worth a piece of paper. Doesn't matter. You still go to a testing ship of a product that everybody now agrees with. And if you really have your risk guys on your back, you just go and publish an addendum or write a new document or use the user stories from your Jira tool, you just print it out and say, there you go, why do you waste the paper? Just go and have a look on the system. All right, so that's a hybrid approach. And the one thing I would be careful of is don't work fragile. Okay, don't work fragile. There is fragile. So fragile is not actually knowing what you're doing in this space. Okay. So make sure you take advantage of your studies and your research to get the building blocks of your knowledge in place and what other great thinkers have learned and how they've applied it. So that when you manage to, as I said, inch by inch, and this is it, inch by inch, right? You're opening up a space for you now to do some agile.
And that's going to happen inch by inch by inch by inch by inch. And then eventually what's quite interesting now, what we're finding as well, is people are saying, well, we can compress these requirements, design, business case, big upfront designs, because we're doing this iterative, cyclical, continuous design, like we saw in a couple of the previous papers, in the Scrum process anyway. And that's exactly what Schwab and Kent and all the guys were thinking when they put the Agile Manifesto together anyway. So over time, this will start to widen, and your influence will start to grow. But Fragile is about putting this in and then not being able to scale it. And that's when you're really going to get stuck, because you're not going to be able to do it at the scale with the repeatability that you then actually need to. And you then start to lose credibility, because you've been talking about Agile, you've had a couple of good projects, but when you really get the opportunity to do it, you mess it up. So just avoid that as well. And that's about not preaching Agile. Remember, the preacher might be hypocritical, right? So evangelize Agile and demonstrate its benefits and value in a vulnerable, authentic manner. So look, I don't know all the answers, but I've seen this work. Let's try it, let's experiment. You saw it worked at CodeFest, we've done a prototype for you. Can we get some money to do some more work and sit with the business guys to create some features? And before you actually know it, you've then got this MVP concept. And this is this prototype or potentially shippable product. And this thing over here, when you talk about what's in the box, what do I get from it? You look at all those failed projects on the Standish report, some of them actually never even got to working software. It was just endless design and workshops and meetings and offsites and strategic breakaways. Most of the time, IT wasn't even in the room. So when I run workshops, and the guys can verify this, we sit down, we do a little bit of analysis, I actually take the lead from the front, I stand up, and I draw some screens up on the whiteboard. And I say to my debbies, I say, have you guys got enough to go back to the office at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning and start building this thing for the business guys? We take a quick picture of it, we stick it on the WhatsApp group, everybody's got it, we go back to the office, and I say, listen, business guys, maybe Friday lunchtime, come around and have a look and see what the guys are building. And then once you've got to that working software, the ability to go back into the cycle and to add additional features is going to be so much more easier than trying to think of all the capabilities and features that you wanted here in a big upfront design requirements analysis upfront. So don't be fragile. Because when you do achieve the impact that you wanted, you might get stuck. How are we doing, guys? Is it useful? Yeah. Going through quite a bit of content here. We have a bit of a chance for a discussion just now. I've touched on a couple of these. We spoke about be agile, small a, and being agile, capital A, right? And if you go and read the article, there's a video in there on complex adaptive systems. I don't know if you've heard of complex adaptive systems, but I believe that agile project teams are kind of modern like complex adaptive systems. So the guy there uses a kids' party. Anybody got kids? Okay. How many have you got? Oh, you got two. I thought you were saying five. Okay. So kids' parties are like agile projects, effectively. But you know they are upfront, right? And you treat them as such. And you have this idea of modulators. Okay? So the kids like the juice. Put some more juice out. The kids like the clown. Keep them another half an hour. You know? The kids are not using the bouncy chair or whatever it is. Okay, just take the bouncy chairs away. So you adapt and it's adaptive, right? It's a complex adaptive system. And the guy uses a kids' party, and I use this idea of being agile and becoming agile. So there's no master plan for the kids' party. There's a good and a bad kids' party. And you sort of want to be flexible enough to get to that. Then the demos are important, so you build the cool products, you're working together, make sure that you continuously go for a test drive on that software. Get out of the forest, use sprints. Here, and in the article I say, guys, when you watch a 100 meter sprint, you can see the start, you can see the end. And all the people are going to, when the gun goes, they're going to run from there to there. And think about business. They watch that race and they can see exactly what's happening. When business feels like they're in a forest, and then as I said earlier, somebody comes rushing out and then rushes off there, and then somebody swings from a tree, and then somebody falls out of a tree. And they're so confused, they don't know how to quantify or engage with all these people running around. You've created a complex, cumbersome project. And you need to get out of that environment and onto the sprint track where everybody can see exactly what's happening. Now that's also quite challenging because you're completely vulnerable and you're completely transparent. And a lot of papers talk about how that then is taken advantage of.
and daily stand-up meetings, managers come to daily stand-up meetings and say, you know, and start to interrogate. Okay. So that's where, you know, leadership's got to play a role, to create a protected environment for people to be transparent about what's happening. And then I've spoken about transactional leadership and agile. Management, as I say, 1975, so even earlier than the 1986 Harvard Business Paper, this is the point I was making earlier. We've lost the focus in IT on the human factors of software development. And I talk about this concept of the coder behind the code. We spend a lot of time and a lot of theory and a lot of research and a lot of methodologies focusing on that code aspect, the input-output process for code, testing and design and development and extreme programming and refactoring and all the rest of it. But there's a coder sitting there producing that code. And I think from a human psychological perspective, we need to just get into that conversation a little bit more. So, he said, Fred Brooks, and it was a seminal work on software development, organization and management are more important factors in success than are the tools or the technical approaches they take. Now, management in those days had a slightly different context, remember, so I like to talk about leadership in organizations. Okay, and it might be a manager in the sense that they sign off the leave of the people they work with, but other than that, they must make sure those people are successful. And this comes to this concept of, this was a slide from DevOps Day. And if you look at the Agile values, we looked at the four earlier, so when you click on Agile Manifesto, you've got those four values. So we value the things on the left more than the things on the right. You go into the principles, there's 12 principles. Okay, and the fifth is about the environment. My entire research is going to be on this concept of the Agile project environment and the impact that leadership and management actually has on it. And I don't know if you watched The Fifth Element, but it was this quintessential particle in the universe that once you found it was kind of amazing in terms of the impact that it could achieve. And in the organization, and again, coming back to this idea of self-organizing teams, if you can create an environment of trust and support within which teams can self-organize and self-actuate in the right environment, I believe that's enough of a start to your agile journey. And from there, you're going to build inch by inch and improve week by week on the way that you run more and more of that project and others. And then I said to the guys, live in the gray. There's 50 shades of gray. Okay? Believe me, right? Do not go into the working world thinking it's all black and white. It isn't, all right? And what you have to understand is that business people, and I work with sales guys, all the time. Our segment is business sales. Okay? Business people live in the gray. And they're doing deals and it's all over the place. Our challenge is that we run a function which at the core of it is in bits and bytes, ones and zeros. Okay? Quantum computing is going to change that. It's quite exciting, but it's binary. Okay? Binary building blocks. It either is or it isn't. Okay? And somewhere we end up with highly ambiguous user requirements and changing, fluctuating world that we then have to make sense of with this binary capability and skill that we're learning. Now, it's where you draw the line that makes the difference, okay? And I suggest you draw the line right in front of your laptop, because the ambiguity and the ability to tolerate ambiguity has got to start with you. Don't think to yourself that you're so tied in with your code that your binary mindset starts to get influenced by the binary capabilities of your computer. Okay, computer is just a tool. You need to live in a world that, as a reality, is completely grey. Absolutely grey. You might have darker shades and things are clearer on a certain day, but then most of the time it's going to be really quite messy. And the one thing that will get you through is consensus, right? Is a team. And you say, look, neither of us have, and we come to this idea of swarm theory, where this idea of centralized intelligent robots versus lots of people working in harmony, being able to achieve meaningful work when they self-organize, is a very, very powerful concept. All right, so yeah, let's talk about self-organizing teams. I think we've done a fair bit of this, and servant leaders, being facilitators, and ensuring that they're able to create the roles and the outcomes from this concept of sitting down together in a protected environment, in a single room,
with enough input from business and IT in the different areas that doesn't rely on one single control point. For information to flow down and work and updates to flow back up the chain. In natural find, you'll find this model is much more empowering for people, for human beings, right? Everybody wants to be empowered and feel part of the winning project team. But again, and we know this, right? This is the army hierarchy. This is the industrial age management style. And in the industrial age, the fact was that the guys on the conveyor belts were just moving widgets, right? And it was very obvious what they were doing. And you could come and sit there with a clipboard and do activity-based costing and efficiency methods, etc. And the manager did know more about that person's work than they did. But in the knowledge worker age, which is the way we're living in now, and all of you are knowledge workers as software engineers, you know more about your work than your manager. So how can a manager manage your performance? How can a manager tell you whether you've done a good job? They probably know a little bit about the output. They can see a good product or a minimum shippable product when they see it. But to think that they can manage the process and the steps by which you create the lines of code on your computer is a complete fallacy. And it's only when you create this consensus about the ways of working and which ones are better or not through a self-organizing team that you then start to change this model where he does know more about the way these guys should be working and he just, he instructs them and he implements them, right? This model is much better. So here are a couple of examples that we see in nature. So these are blue mackerels, and this is called a bait ball, and they self-organize into this massive fish, so that the predators, and I'm not talking about project managers. I'm not talking about project managers, I'm talking about natural predators in the water, will be scared of this, because it's a much bigger mass of self-organized, structured. But nobody can. There's no master fish here. They just intuited the best defense mechanism because they were self-organized. And so we see this emerging in natural ecosystems. And then you see this murmuration here of birds, and it creates beautiful patterns and pictures as swarms of birds move through the air. And this is to protect themselves. This is for efficiency in the air. We know the V-shaped formation. This, and man, you know far more about it than I do, but this has efficiencies in terms of the movement of these birds from one place to another. And then what you'll find a lot of swarm theory in robots, swarm robotics, and each of these are little miniature robots, 1 or 2 4 kilobytes. I think the processing power and the memory of each of those little robots is minuscule, but they've all been coded with very specific rules. And when you put them all into a space and you've given a broad set of instructions and you've stood back and you're going to get watch these YouTube videos and these robots just sort of start to self-organize. And there's no master or central intelligence in here. And this is this big transition that we're making in the world between the centralized command and control approach of large armies and factory organizations to self-organizing units of work and people that are empowered to take charge of destiny of the outcomes that they need to achieve. So for me, this is quite fascinating. And then we spoke about CodeFest quite a bit, and I'd love to have a little bit of discussion, and I think we've got sort of 5 or 10 minutes to have a quick discussion on it. Yes, sir?
What is the ratio being for this rugby coach?
Okay, so the question was, where's the referee? I think the referee, so there has to be a level playing field, okay, and there has to be a marking out of where we can play, and the referee is going to own that and control it. And I must say that in my role, I tend to play a little bit of that, because you can see when there's a foul and a person has broken the rules. And again, it comes down to, and the foul and the rules that are broken are not mine. Most often they are values and mutual respect and basic ethics in the workplace and ways of working that we all, in terms of humanity,
understand we should be doing. But then you let the ball play. And you say, guys, scrum and go to second and third and fourth and fifth phase. And a good rep will create a running game. So to answer a question, you know, you could have like a CIO who then has overall responsibility for an IT organization, but creates the environment within which business can come and engage. And you know, when we've had our barriers, I've said to the team, I've said a natural reaction is you then lock the door and you say, business, get out. You can post your BRS. You see that letterbox there? You can post the BRS in the letterbox there. Ring the bell and we'll come and fetch it. And then we'll put your go live dates up on the board outside there. You know what I mean? And then you think you're creating a level playing field. And you can now have your nice little game inside. But just only half the team. So all of those types of issues will vary. And who that referee emerges, I think, is often a natural process. And it will differ, I think. But I don't think you can have chaos. You can't have anarchy. And again, this is complex adaptive systems. You can't have anarchy at a kid's party. So the mom, who's hosting the kid's party, knows when things start getting out of control. The kids start breaking their arms on, you know.
So is that the product owner?
No, I think a product owner is knows features and designs. Scrum Master could be on a daily basis. And then you could have your CIO almost.
I think you might back in the team. There's a score of one that's organizing team.
Yep.
So the team is taking a lot more from the referee themselves,
yep,
the accountant. So
yep,
as the self-organizer. So you won't see a lot more happening from the referee. You only have to eat the screen. And then the referee will come down and understand and touch the average.
But I think the point is you do need a ref. You don't want a ref that suffocates the game, but he does need to intervene where there's unfair play. Questions from the back, guys? Yes, sir. Shanton.
Yeah.
How you doing?
Okay, so you touched on the fact that the same logical implications.
Yes, sir.
Kind of important, right? As well as the fact, I'm looking at practical centers, right? And you're looking at KTS custom support, which is critical for Agile environment, right? I'm looking from a practical perspective. So, you've got business here who's saying, and I'll use an example, like, say they want a particular app to develop, right? And say, okay, you've got a good